just a minute, John. Let's set the... Just a minute, Councillor Morrison. Sorry, Councillor Curran. Let's set the tone for the rest of the meeting. Okay? I do struggle sometimes when there's lots going on and I can't read what's happening, but on the whole, I don't think I needed to read it to know that possibly people were speaking out of turn. Please do not speak over the Lord Mayor, whether it's me or next year's Lord Mayor or the Lord Mayor in 10 years' time. If the Lord Mayor stands up or goes to speak, could we all respect that and all please be quiet? Enough chairing council meetings, and I think all Lord Mayors try to be fair and let a debate take place. And it's always my personal ambition, I'm sure it is of all Lord Mayors, to let the voice be heard. Okay? And so the intention, my intention is to make sure that people do get that opportunity, right? Which was what I was trying to do beforehand. I don't want to stifle debate, but it has to come in the right order, right? So I tried to explain what I wanted the procedure to be. I tried to put some guidelines around timings. That's fairly loose. If people have got something to say, there's no need to curtail a debate if something is to be said that's of genuine concern to the speaker and the city. So I think we can live with that, right? I'd like this, now, between now and the end of this debate, to be about the council, the budget and Liverpool, and I'm sure everybody else does. Okay? But I'd like to be on the terms where we get the opportunity to hear people speak and we're able to respond in a reasonable manner. Right, Councillor Morrison, would you like to now speak to apologise? Thank you.
Lord Mayor, we've just spoken privately and I asked if I could do this now. Obviously, there was a miscommunication before the meeting and I wanted to move the amendments and I apologise for my behaviour towards you as chair and I respect you great personally anyway over the past 4 years of the advice and guidance that you gave me. But I'd also like to thank Joe and the cabinet member and others for coming over and speaking about this very sensitive issue that has an effect on my personal life over my child's upbringing as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now, I know that Councillor Radford and Councillor Coyne would like to speak, but I just want to reiterate now where we're up to and how I'd like the rest of this meeting to go. So Joe has given his speech. I am now, in a moment, going to ask if there are any questions. And could we accept that questions are questions and not speeches? Right? So we'll ask Joe some questions and Joe will respond to those. I'm sorry, Mayor Anderson. Right, do beg your pardon. Mayor Anderson will respond. We then have two amendments. So the amendments will be moved and spoken to and voted on. And then we will go back to the budget. And if you wish to speak on the budget, you will get your opportunity. Okay? So you can speak to the amendments and you can speak to the budget as well. And don't forget, every vote we take this afternoon is a card vote. Right? So, I'm sincerely hoping there'll be no more adjournments, no more shouting. We may not like what people say, but we will respect their right to say it. And at the end of the meeting, the votes will have taken place and the budget will be set. Okay? Everybody happy? Good. Right. Are there now any questions for Mayor Anderson regarding the budget? Councillor Radford.
Madam Mayor, can I ask two questions? One of the Mayor, but also I'd like officers for an explanation. It's a separate question, but I think it comes from officers rather than the Mayor because it's not a political decision. On the first question to the Mayor, can I ask thank the Mayor for his courtesy in complimenting the all-party groups for participation in the Budget Working Party, but could you clarify that the discontinuation of this Working Party meeting this year has not been because of our willingness to participate, because it was left vague. We thought the Budget Working Party was going to continue to meet to monitor the progress of the budget and for us to continue making the contribution we have. And I want to place on record the Liberal Party group was willing to do so, but this year it hasn't convened. I mean, wondered if there was any particular explanation, because we were a little, to be candid, disappointed we haven't been able to contribute this year. But not by our own keeping. The second question, if I may, my Mayor, is this. We tabled three items for consideration and drafting of amendments. Three items which we consider would have been significant investor save models: a reduction of tax threshold on vacant properties, which would have gained £1 million, copying the Leeds initiative on vacant dwellings, which would have helped us raise the Derrick's target, and an extension of the composting scheme we did in Tubrook, and I believe colleagues in Greenbank have done, whether that could be done by investment save. We told they couldn't be done for this year's budget, but could be done for next year's budget, but we couldn't move an amendment. And I'm puzzled from officers. If we're talking about a three-year budget programme, we've agreed to a three-year budget, and there's some positive proposals to improve the investment to save on that budget, why they can't be moved, and I have to say, I deeply regret the lack of explanation from officers as to why three items, three positive suggestions, cannot be tabled today, and I want to put on my group's objection. I think the city's lost out, and I think it's not a just debate, and I cannot comprehend why, when 1 minute you talk about a three-year budget process, we can't have budget amendments that affect this year and potentially next.
Lord Mayor, thank you for that. I'll respond to both of the points you raised, because the influence on your second point was made by me, and I'll explain why. The first one is, yes, I do appreciate the Liberals' contribution to the budget process. We set a three-year process. If you recall, sort of last year, the Greens in their usual sort of world of kerfuffle and confusion were talking about, and Councillor Kemp also said that they might want to join. I thought, look, we've set the budget, we've got to stick to that budget, and it's the same point that I've just made around the CRU. We've made that commitment, this is what we're going to do, and that's how we have set it. So that's why I've introduced the seminars in terms of giving members an update and the Mayoral Select Committee to give progress on how things are going. And a cabinet meeting every 6 weeks. We also have a capital update and a revenue update, where everybody's welcome to come along and talk to us about how the budget is going. I also give updates on the budget pressures that we face, as we've discussed in previous cabinet meetings, about the adult social care, the children's social care pressures that we face. So there's plenty of opportunity for people to engage. I felt that now that we've set that, and I've made it absolutely clear, and I'll do so again, that I thank you in particular for being party to the budget setting process then. But I think that we are moving progress on that budget. That's why I think you agreed with me that it was right to do a three-year budget. So we've set out that, unless there was any dramatic changes or whatever, I think the avenues of giving information are clear enough and plentiful enough that cabinet seminars, like for instance, which we did on the presentation and why we went for the 1.9, and also the Mayoral Select Committee of ways to do that. On the second point where you raised the issue of your proposal around refurbishment of properties, you talk about the tax band and the refurbishment. We talk about, for instance, the new home bonus and stuff and how that can be used. The new home bonus is retrospective, so you have to earn it first before you get it, so that we can't put into the budget what we don't know we've got. Let me tell you what I've set in train is that I've actually, we had a meeting today that discussed it with the Director for Regeneration, the Director for Finance, and the Chief Executive and myself, and other officers as well. We're looking at how we do step up the bringing in more voids. Yeah, the Cabinet members also aware of it as well. And we're going to set up looking at how we can fund through capital receipt, a project that works out how to bring more and more voids back into use. And that will be invest to earn. But what that enables us to do is not link it to the budget process now, because, as you know, home bonus money is retrospective. So what we can't do is put a figure based on 600 new properties, but we don't know whether we'll reach that target or not. Then, of course, we have to wait a year or thereabouts before people actually pay council tax. So we wait a year before we get the new home bonus, and then we wait a period of time as well while people are in before they pay council tax. So I hope that explains, but I think... Right, it doesn't look right.
Chair, I can understand the political considerations. No,
Councillor Radford, yes. we're going to enter into a... You get your answer, you don't like it, then you ask a bit more.
Chair, it shouldn't be the decision of the leader of council or the mayor to decide whether amendments are suitable or convenient. It is the legal officer's opinion. If a proposal's drafted on a 3-year budget, and I accept the mayor's perfectly right, the amendments we sought would have affected next year's budget. But as we set a 3-year process, why can that not be moved now? Because that is a proposal to affect the budget.
Well, I thought Councillor.
I understand the
point. Okay, thank you, Councillor Radford.
But I think the member's right to move.
I thought we just agreed. Right.
I thought, Lord Mayor, my explanation was very clear in that what we can't do is accept a budget amendment, if that's what you want to call it, a budget amendment based on what might be. That's what we can't do. And what I'm trying to explain is because the new homes bonus is retrospective and it doesn't happen until you've actually done it, what we can't do is commit to a figure. You're talking about bringing in an extra 600 homes or 200 homes or whatever it is. Well, we won't get that until post 2017 anyway. And the fact, the reason why is because technically it's not acceptable. And I'm trying to explain that to you. It's not. And I've also, Lord Mayor, I've also said to him that we are setting up a task group looking at, not only the task group, but setting up a project team looking at how we do that. I really can't explain it any more clearly.
A question has been asked, a response has been given. You're not quite satisfactory, but we can't enter into a debate at this point. So, are there any more questions? In that case, we now move to some budget amendments have been received from Councillor John Coyne and then from Councillor Radford. And these are attached, so we will now move to the first amendment from Councillor Coyne, and I will ask Councillor Coyne to speak to that, and when I nod at you, that means that I've got your name down.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. The amendment is in three parts. Actually conceived as three separate or separable amendments that could be voted on each. And indeed, if any member should wish to support any part of the three-part amendment, they could move to have the motion taken in parts when the time comes. Referring back now to the Mayor's wide-ranging speech, there are a couple of things I'd like to respond to at this point. I wrote down one phrase that he said that struck me as significant. The vain hope that we will get a different government. Now, the first part of the amendment, the moratorium, 3-month moratorium proposed in the services which could be subject to a moratorium, does rest on the possibility that we could get a government which behaves differently. And if you remember last meeting, you voted to support what's quoted in the text of the amendment. Council further calls on all potential parties of government to agree to an emergency uplift in funding for local government from 2015-2016 so that this local authority and others can restore services that have been cut since 2010. So that possibility was recognised by you at the last meeting. And this part of the amendment rests on that possibility, that if we're going to have the prospect of a change of mind from a different government coming in, that is going to provide this local authority with some of the funding anyway that's gone, would we still carry on cutting those services in the next financial year that currently we plan to do? Now, the list is not necessarily the most vital services that need to be protected. The list is a list of those services which are amenable to this moratorium, because decisions have been taken that make it hard to suspend action on other services that we might wish to pause on. And indeed, the voluntary organisations that Councillor Morrison referred to might well be on that list, but we were advised that because they'd all been informed about what their grants were for next year, it was not possible to apply that pause to them. But something like, for example, the school crossing patrol service, it's mad, surely, to cut school crossing patrols and then the government will come in and provide you with the money, we hope, that will make that decision not necessary. So that's why a 3-month pause in the first financial year of the cuts that we plan to take over the year is proposed. But that needs to be funded, because if you're going to take a slice out of the next financial year and not make progress on the cuts that you plan to do, you have to find the money to fill that saving which you've not made. And we've identified just over £1 million from the two funds, the Mayoral Fund, used to call the Leaders Fund, and the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund, which fund very good projects. We agreed, I think when we last time we spoke, that those funds are useful because they provide funding for important things. No one is saying they're bad, we say they're good, but to quote other Cabinet members who've spoken, we are prioritising the priorities. And there are things which could be paused in order to let other services go ahead. So, returning to some of the comments that the Mayor made in his wide-ranging statement before, £80 per annum would be the consequence of the second part of the Green Party amendment, the proposed raise in council tax to 6%. £80 per annum. That's actually not right. The amount would be £40 for a band-aid property. The other area of error, I'm afraid, on the Mayor's list is to conflate Green Party with Militant. I mean, Militant, of course, doesn't exist today. You have Tusk. These two different political strands have certain things in common. Principally, we identify the cuts are wrong, but we have different remedies and what to do about them. And it does them no favours, or indeed us, to try and confuse the politics of these two different approaches. Every budget amendment which we've proposed has been balanced. We've not been in denial about the need to deal with the cuts. The government is taking the money out of the council's bank account. The council has to decide what it does in consideration from that. If it was possible somehow to transcend the laws of arithmetic and say we don't have to take cognizance of that loss of money from a bank account, we'd be in a different situation. We don't follow that philosophy, we don't follow that those politics. We have some certain things in common, and we criticise the government for taking that money away, but the remedy is not to be in denial about the cuts. The remedy is to try and accommodate them and try and manage them and try and move for a change of government, because we need to get anti-austerity parties elected in the next government. And I say anti-austerity parties because the current prospectus from the prospective Labour government is not as helpful as it needs to be. The government spending envelope is going to be preserved. We had this something called a Charter for Budget Responsibility that was voted on last month in the House of Commons. One of the local members of parliament didn't vote for that, the other four did. And that's projecting the government's spending severity over at least the next 2 years of the parliament. Now, we've heard that the government will, and within that envelope, local authority funding is not protected. NHS is, education is, but not local authority funding is. But we've heard maybe the government is going to look kindly on Liverpool within that overall envelope. And that's possible. But if they do that, they would have to say to places like Lancaster and Cheshire, we're going to take even more money off you. Now, I don't think in the marginal constituencies on the doorstep next month and into towards May that they will get away with saying, we're going to take more money from Chester, we're going to give it to Liverpool. Are they going to say that? Yes, thank you very much. But I think in practice, I think in practice you will find that we don't get that promise from that government, and you need, in the next Parliament, a strong wedge of anti-austerity MPs, which will include the Nationalists and indeed, we hope, some Greens. We need to press for a change of mind on the prospectus for local government in the next Parliament. So the vain hope that we will get a different government must not be a vain hope. There is still time, and indeed the Green Party is part of the process in trying to press and make explicit any implicit promises that the Mayor may think he has had. I want to see something written down to say, yes, we will withstand the criticism we're going to take by taking the money away from the more prosperous areas, and we will indeed give this money to places like Liverpool. If that can happen, we'd be in a different situation. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Right, I have the following people who've indicated that they would like to speak. Councillor Kennedy, Councillor Small, Councillor Corbyn, Councillor Moore, Councillor Noakes. So I'll call you in that order. Councillor Kennedy.
I hope to be very brief, Lord Mayor. I mean, okay, the Charter for Budget Responsibility. It's great to see the Liberals, the Liberal Democrats and the Greens signing up for the Charter for Budget Irresponsibility, because there's no responsibility within this. You really should go a little bit deeper into things, John. It's not so much back of the fag packet stuff, this. It's a bit more substantial than that, but it is roughly, it's had about the much same amount of thought into it as possible. So what you're basically saying, with the school crossing patrol example, we should just stop searching for alternative ways to fund the school crossing patrol. We should stop our efforts to ask schools to contribute to that. That's what you're saying in this budget amendment. You talk about parking services review. What do you mean, stopping a review to see how we can run it more efficiently, how we can make more money from it, or more, perhaps get more somebody else to take responsibility for it and run it more effectively? You're going to stop all of this work to make our budget work better? You're just saying, stop these things?
Do you want me to respond?
No, you can't. No, you can't. But I just want to really, what I wanted to deal with was with my friend, the Mayor, Joe Anderson's description of you in sandals. I think he's being very kind to you. Because certainly, when the militant were here in the 1980s, they were real revolutionaries. I mean, they talked about no cuts in jobs, no rent rises, no rate rises, and your call seems to be no planning and building control service review. I mean, that's about as much as you've actually come up with. And then you say within the bit about the council tax increase of 6% in a referendum, they said no rent rises. Well, that's what some of your members are saying in Brighton. But here you're saying we'll have a 6% rise, and we believe that a campaign to save vital services like the Planning and Building Control Service Review will be paid for by a 6% tax rise, and that would be politically achievable. Yet when you look at the papers, it talks about a 60-odd million gap in the budget for the year, and then your motion itself says you're going to raise 5 million. If you manage to actually get it through. But of course you know that it's nothing more than a £150,000 punt on whether you'd actually get that agreement to that rate rise in the first place. £150,000 at risk. I'll tell you what to do with your £150,000 if you've got it. You can go down to William Hills and put it on the 33-1 against chance of Martin Dobson getting elected in Liverpool Riverside. That'll probably pay for the whole of the budget gap if you win that bet.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I want to speak against this amendment because I think it does encapsulate everything that is wrong about the Green Party in this city and in this country. It's economically illiterate. When you scratch the surface, it's socially regressive. And it's more about playing politics with people's aspirations, jobs and services than it is about the real needs of this city or this country. And perhaps the worst aspect of this amendment, Lord Mayor, is the 6% council tax rise that's being proposed on top of rises that they've proposed at least over the past 2 or 3 years. And this isn't a modest proposal, as Councillor Coyne has suggested previously. This will cause real hardship to working families across this city. It will hit the most vulnerable and poorest people in this city who have to pay council tax because it's not covered through council tax benefit. And remember, council tax isn't based on ability to pay. It's a regressive form of taxation. And in a city where we're seeing the average household £1,600 worse off a year because of the cost of living crisis, and we see, and it's not £40 a year for a Band-Aid property, it's £54 a year for a Band-Aid property, which has been confirmed by the officers. And to add insult to injury, this is now, I'm not going to give way, John, it's £54, it's £54. And to add insult to injury, Lord Mayor, he's making the taxpayers of this city pay to rebuild and for a referendum that nobody wants. £200,000 it will cost to rebuild and to ask people the question, do you want to pay a silly amount of extra tax that they're going to answer no to? And that's money that could be used for frontline services. We've heard from Councillor Morrison about the CRU budget. We've heard about domiciliary care. We've heard about social care. That is all money, that £200,000, that could be used for those frontline services and not on a vanity project that is abdicating your responsibility and playing politics with people's aspirations in this city. And there is an alternative, Lord Mayor, to this regressive madness from the Greens. If you compare what this Labour mayor and this Labour administration have done, we've handled the budget in a responsible way. We've had to take some difficult decisions, but we've been responsible with the city's finances. We've maintained our council tax base, and the 1.9% increase, though difficult, is fair, it's proportionate, and it's sensible. It won't make people in this city suffer in the way that a 6% increase would do. We've opened this city for business to get jobs and investment into this city. And that's something that the Green Party have opposed consistently, whether it's IFB, whether it's Stonebridge Cross, whether it's the supermarket in Park Road, whether it's Project Jennifer. All of these projects the Green Party have opposed. And I'd say this to the Green Party. If you're going to redistribute jobs, if you're going to redistribute wealth and power and opportunities, you first have to create economic growth. This zero growth economics, steady state economics, it's about a permanent recession. And how that can benefit a city like Liverpool, how that can benefit some of the poorest people in Western Europe is anybody's guess. That's what the party opposite believe in. And there is a regressive way to maintain your council tax base. And it's not a 6% council tax increase. We're doing that in a progressive way. And if you look at the medium-term financial plan, you'll see an increased council tax base of 3.2 million. And we've done that by increasing the choice of housing, by trying to build more houses that are plans A and B. We've done that by investing to Finch Farm, Cunard, Royal Insurance Building. All of these projects are bringing in income into the council that's being used to support frontline services for the most vulnerable residents of this city. And that's something, all of those projects, the party opposite have sniped about, they've opposed, they've stared, because they haven't supported a progressive way to increase council tax. And I just want to touch, Lord Mayor, on the housing and increasing choice in housing in this city. The party opposite, led by Councillor Coyne, have shamelessly colluded and connived with the Conservative government, with Eric Pickles, going back to 2007, while people are living in substandard homes and we're not bringing in money with council tax. You have worked with the Conservatives on your own.
At budget meetings, if you ask rhetorical questions, would you make sure it's a rhetorical question? Otherwise, people feel duty bound to respond. Councillor Coyne, please try to keep your language in accordance with what the dignity of the chamber deserves. Otherwise, we just degenerate into a shouting match. Councillor, I've omitted to mention that Councillor Crowe is seconding the motion and will be speaking at the end before Mayor Anderson gets the right to respond. So I think if you want to respond to any particular points, that's your opportunity then. If there is any more foul language from anybody, then I would just simply ask for them to be removed straight away. So that's a warning to you all. Councillor Corbett, thank you.
Speaking to the main motion, not the amendment.
Flip
Moore. Councillor Moore.
Lord Mayor, I think I'm actually going to do what Councillor Coyne suggested when he complained earlier that he wasn't able to present his motion in three different parts, because I'm just going to focus on the final bit of it, point C, because colleagues have already ably demonstrated the flaw in the earlier elements. Lord Mayor, it's been apparent for some time, and my colleague Councillor Mumby has mentioned it on many occasions, that the Green Party in this city were anti-politics. But today, through this motion, they've not only gone anti-politics, they've gone further. They're anti-scrutiny. And that may seem a surprise, if indeed we're surprised by anything that the Green Party do anymore. But if we have a closer look at the motion, we really shouldn't be surprised, because it displays what at best is a complete misunderstanding of the role and the value of scrutiny, and at worst a view that scrutiny only exists to get the Mayor and the Cabinet to do what the Green Party want. Because the motion says that we should recognise that the scrutiny function has seldom changed any executive decision. But scrutiny isn't only about changing executive decisions once they've been made. It's about informing decisions, it's about pre-decision scrutiny, it's about shaping policy and thinking, and it's about supporting good governance. And it often has. I can think of many occasions when I was a cabinet member, when we had good quality debates and discussions in select committee, and many suggestions that helped improve our decision making. And I'm surprised that the Greens can't remember that. Because for a good portion of that time, Lord Mayor, Councillor Coyne was the chair of the committee. And a chair who, to the best of my knowledge, received without complaint the very allowances which today his motion is proposing to scrap. So that raises a bigger question. If they don't believe in scrutiny, if they don't believe in getting involved, if they don't believe in supporting good decision making, then what's the point of Green Party councillors? In 2 months' time, they'll go to the electorate and they'll ask the electorate to elect more Green councillors to hold the administration to account. Yet in this motion, they're saying that they want to abolish the very mechanism by which they can do that. And they're saying that the committees that they once chaired and that Councillor Jennings once oversaw as Chair of Overview and Scrutiny are worthless. If the Green Party can't be confident of their own ability to make decisions, then why on earth should the electorate be? But Lord Mayor, even if the Green Party did succeed in abolishing scrutiny virtually in this chamber, they won't get rid of all scrutiny full stop, because the scrutiny of the Green Party policies that Councillor Anderson, Mayor Anderson mentioned earlier will continue. And will continue to scrutinise those policies to freeze growth, to cause chaos in the school admission system, to drag all taxpayers into the 40% band, and we'll do it publicly, and we'll make sure that the electorate know. Because they may seek to diminish scrutiny within this town hall, but they'll never run from the scrutiny of their own party's policies and their own party's decisions, because we will be more than happy to make sure it continues.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Firstly, can I start off by thanking you, Lord Mayor? I think it's been very difficult for you this evening. Quite often, people in this chamber, certainly in the opposition benches, would like to try and make out that it's somehow the Labour group, simply because there's a lot of us that behave badly in this chamber. I think you've seen tonight just who the people who behave badly in this chamber are, and they're not on this side of the chamber. And I think that's quite shameful when we consider the issues that are at hand, and I hope that all of you go home tonight and consider the way that you've behaved. Lord Mayor, the proposals that the Greens have put forward, as have been pointed out, are completely economically illiterate. I think you would hope that at some point they would have considered it themselves. Clearly not. They're asking us to effectively go for a £4.5 million increase on the basis that it may only be a £1.1 million increase. They seem to forget that we have to set a budget for the whole year and not just for the first 3 months. But they also want that to be hanging for 3 months to see possibly what happens with a government who, according to their timetable, pretty much on day one are going to be making decisions and changing things. Added on top of that, they want to kick the whole process even further into the long grass by having a referendum on raising the council tax by 6%. Let me tell you something about the referendum, Councillor Coyne. If you've not figured it out yet, now, Eric Pickles is many things, and he does many, many daft things. We could be here all night talking about that. But in reality, he isn't daft. And the way it's set out is that we really, really find it incredibly difficult to ever get to a point where you can have a referendum. You are hanging the budget in the wind and waiting to see if something can happen, whilst at the same time, we still have to pay people, we still have to deliver services, and we still have to run a city. And yet, fully not in full knowledge of that, you want us to go out to the city and see if we can win that. I can tell you now, and if you've been around politics for so long, you've got the idea that you're going to go out there and do that, then good luck to you. I mean, we're not going to do it, but good luck to you, because you get laughed out. You get laughed out like the house that I visited in Greenbank the other day, where when I mentioned the Greens on the doorstep, the guy simply went apoplectic. Because his mother lived in Brighton, and he had to experience what it was like down there. His mother lived several miles from the town centre and was being slapped with parking charges. So you can see the way that they handle Brighton. Really, there's a point to the way that they'll handle it here. Lorna, they want to pay for this referendum, possibly through the referendum itself, possibly through councillors' allowances. As Councillor Moore has pointed out, they already don't value what scrutiny does. They seem to not value what councillors do. Now, it may not be trendy, it may not be nice, but I'll stand up for councillors because I think they do a great job. Certainly, on this side of the chamber, they do fantastic work in their communities, day in, day out. But if you don't value the work that your own councillors do in your wards, then really you should take a look at yourself rather than come to this chamber and attacking everybody else. I'll end with pointing out that this back of a lentil packet budget that they put forward is just absolutely ridiculous. Do you know what it is? We've all heard the shouts. We've all heard the shouts outside there. We've got a new one for the Greens now. It's all ifs, all buts. We can't deal with the cuts. Because that's what your proposals that you're putting forward this evening the city has to face. Absolutely ridiculous, absolutely incompetent, and you'll soon find out in May what the rest of the electorate thinks.
It's the main debate, my old man.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Coyne, are we in the same room? Are we in the same room? Because I just sat through a three-quarter of an hour speech from Mayor Johansson, where he's told us all, and most of us took this in over 2 years ago, that there's a 58% cut in our budget. That we are struggling to manage what we've got at the moment. That ifs and buts, you know, that word if tonight has and have been bandied around this chamber, the littlest, one of the littlest words in the English language, and it's been bandied around this chamber non-stop. If we don't get the uplift that we get, then we fall over. That's damn serious statements. That tells me, as an elected councillor for the moment for this council and as a resident of this city, that we've got one hell of a time coming forward for this city and for its residents. And let's be honest, even those councillors are getting an allowance for them as well. You talk, John, about revenue lines, and you talk about the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund and the Mayoral Fund. Well, my understanding is, and I'm sure Mayor Anderson will take to task if I'm wrong, that funding is used, I don't think it was ever envisaged to do, to support some of the services that we are still to fund. And the Mayor does that by attracting other partners to actually put some money in to actually deliver that particular issue, project, service or whatever that we can't. So we match fund with a lot of it to try and deliver some of those outcomes that we're losing, like a leaking tap of the water. And the other thing, John, is, and I'm sure again Mayor Anderson will tell me, how long is the mayoral funding piece of string? Because if we're going to be paying for all of this, it's obviously Joe's getting a lot more money than he's told us. I don't think so, because I'm the chair of this committee and you know, do know the details. And then on your page, you talk about this referendum and a 6% tax rise would be politically achievable given the fiscal bill. John, I don't know about your ward, but in Chibuk and in other worlds of this city, our damn residents can't afford to pay the bills and the taxes as it is now. So God help us. You know, John, I love you dearly, but sometimes you grasp on reality. It's either you don't explain yourself properly or it really is a fact. You haven't got a grasp on reality. It's 3 months, so I'm trying to be serious. I'm really not taking, you know, the you-know-what from you. So you're saying, okay, so for 3 months, we have this moratorium. So for 3 months, that man there, and this lot here, and that lot there, I'm spending 3 months trying to manage the city because we've got this 3 months moratorium. Who the hell is going to be working on our survival post-2017 if, as I believe, and I said this at the Mayoral Select Committee, we have a 50% chance of Labour getting in, we've more likely got a 33% chance of it being some sort of coalition at the end of the day. Is that if word again? At the end of the day, my point is, this is a nonsense. We can't afford to do that. A, we can't afford to do it with the resources we haven't got, with the finances we haven't got, and with the staff we haven't got. You heard Joe Anderson saying earlier on, well done the staff. I've said publicly, and I've said this at the Mayor's Selection Committee, I'm amazed we've still got staff. Because I wouldn't want to be an employee of this council at the moment, because we employ people to do one job. Most of our staff are doing 3, 4, and 5 jobs, and they haven't had a pay rise. I mean, that is loyalty with a capital L. I just don't think this amendment does us any good, you any good, and it certainly doesn't do the city any good. Councillor Brown, did you want to speak? No, sorry. Councillor Crowe.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm just going to speak about the part of our amendment, which section 2, which covers our proposal to try and prevent some of the cuts happening in this city by holding a referendum to raise capital tax by 6%. Hopefully try and take a little bit of the hyperbole out of this discussion. We know full well that all the cuts being imposed on Liverpool Council cannot be stopped by raising council tax, and the things are only going to start getting better if the next government reverses the planned cuts and the increases council funding, so some of what we've lost already can be restored. However, at this moment in time, council tax is the one thing that we've got power to change. That's the only way we can reduce some of the cuts. A 6% rise in council tax will cost Band B households £1.20 a week. When you take in the £1.99% rise that's already proposed, that's only actually an extra 80p per week that we're calling for, which is half what was quoted in the Mayor's speech and also less than what was quoted in Councillor Small's speech. We totally understand that council tax is not the most progressive tax. We'd like to see local authorities having much more flexibility and much more control over ways of raising revenue so that the situation can be tailored to our local situation. However, right now, if we're going to set a legal budget, we've got the choice of raising council tax and retaining some of the services threatened with the cut, or we can carry on cutting our services. And however flawed council tax is, it's not as regressive as taking away services that people depend on. So we're hoping that in the future things will get better for Liverpool, and the future government will restore some of the funding, and things will get better in the future. And that's why I think it's relevant that we are actually proposing to spend a lot of the money preventing further cuts to any of the children or youth services, any of the budget lines in that section. We're calling for the money to be used to stop the plan cuts that will impact on children's services such as children's social care, transport to school for children with special educational needs and other really important services like that. We're not being completely prescriptive either. We're not accounting for all the money that we're going to raise, so there'll be other things that can be said too. So basically, in conclusion, asking for more money off people is never going to be the most popular thing to do, but in the face of these cuts, I think it is actually the right thing to do.
Mayor Anderson, do you want to respond to the amendment?
I stand by the comments that I made before about the militants in sandals, and the reason why I did that is because to emphasise that the very same rhetoric and the very same false promises were made by militants in the 80s, today we still regret that. We still desperately fight to combat that. I'm ashamed to say there was a Labour administration. We're still dealing with that. Here we have a situation, the absurdity of what's being getting asked of us to support. In each section of the amendment, I don't intend to address it. Let me say, on school crossings, Councillor Kennedy pointed out that we're talking to schools and we're trying to make savings there with schools doing more. There will be no loss of any school patrols. None at all. The bottom line is, everything that we've done on libraries and children's centres and all of the savings that we've made, if you had your way, we wouldn't be looking exploring those, because you're simply saying, let's have a moratorium and don't make any more cuts. That's the reality of the world in which you live. It's £54 for an A band council tax. It's £80 for a D council tax. Whatever figure it is too much to ask the people of this city to pay for the mistakes of other people, and we will not do it. But let me then deal with some of the other things that you make. He shouted out, make notes here, he shouted out, Finch Farm, Finch Farm. Let me tell him a little bit about Finch Farm, and he ridiculed. £800,000.
I think we didn't oppose.
£800,000 we get in revenue from Finch Farm. The City Council,
yeah, we support
in
that.
Making that investment, is 128% better off for that investment. We will get a return of 128% more than we invested, and a revenue of £800,000. And on Cunard.
We support that.
And in Cunard, £400,000 revenue on the other investments that we've made all add up to more than your back of your lentil packers amendment. And then, the best part about it for me is the fact that he talks about he wants to scrap scrutiny committees. Couldn't make it up, could you? This is a person
that has argued publicly that the mayor doesn't get scrutinised enough. You've heard him. I'm not making it up. You've heard him. He goes to the press, he goes to Radio Merseyside bleating about no scrutiny. Now, because he didn't get their own way on bus lanes, incidentally, he chaired the scrutiny committee, him. Because he didn't get his own way, he now wants to scrap them. He couldn't make it up. I've got a little grandson at home who talks like that. He says, Grandad, and he goes and sucks in the corner if he doesn't get what he wants. That's what he's proposed. Let's do away with scrutiny. Well, let's go the whole lot then. Go on, off you go. Go on. Don't come, I'll just run everything. You don't bother. Don't bother turning up for anything. Let's scrap the elections then and just have Joe running everything. That's the absurd position that he's going down. I actually say, on every single thing you've moved, on every single thing you've moved, it's just a nonsense. It just really is. You know, and then we get, you know, Councillor Crowe saying that it's because people struggle that we need to put up the council tax. Don't need any lessons from you. How long have you been on the council? Why are we asking you?
1 year.
1 year. We know how hard this city has been hit, and we know how people are suffering. We don't need any lectures from you. We live with it. My family suffers it as well. My children suffer it. My relations suffer it. The fact of the matter is, we're doing what we believe to be the fairest way of addressing the situation that we've been put in. Not with false dawns, pipe dreams, pie-in-the-sky brain freezers on reality. We're dealing with a situation that has to be dealt with, and we'll try and get our way out of it. But let me just make one point on the point that he makes about ifs and maybes, if your aunt had the things he shouts about, she'd be your uncle. Let me say this, that hopefully, we will get an administration led by the Labour Party that is committed to a fairer distribution of funding. That's what it's committed to. Now, I don't really care whether it's in leafy Wokingham or West Oxfordshire or whatever that loses out, as long as this city deals with its fair share of cuts, not an unfair cut to a city that desperately needs that money. And that's why, you know, we will completely and simply reject your amendment. But equally, we will point out to the people in this city what you actually stand for, what you actually believe in. And quite frankly, it doesn't amount to much.
Right, we now move.
Councillor Ashton Armstrong.
We are voting on the amendment as moved by Councillor Coyne.
Councillor Ashton Armstrong. Aspinall. Councillor Banks. Councillor Barrington. Councillor Beaumont. Councillor Brennan. Councillor Brown. Councillor Kane. Councillor Calvert. Councillor Castles.
Yes.
Councillor Clark. Councillor Conception. Councillor Corbett. Councillor Corrigan. Councillor Coyne. Councillor Crofts. Councillor Crone. Councillor Cummins. Councillor Dean. Councillor Adele Dowling. Councillor Brian Dowling. Councillor Foxley. Councillor Frankel. Councillor Francis. Councillor Roy Gladden. Councillor Rosler, Councillor Clare, Councillor Hanratty, Councillor Hanson, Councillor Harrison, Councillor Herring, Councillor Hinnigan, Councillor Hirschfield, Councillor Hunt, Councillor Hughes, Councillor Hurley, Councillor Jennings, Councillor Jobling, Councillor Jones, Councillor Kemp, Councillor Kennedy, Councillor Kent, Councillor Knight. Councillor Kushner. Councillor McCallie. Councillor McIntosh.
Against.
Councillor McClendon.
Against.
Councillor Mitchell.
Against.
Councillor Moore.
Against.
Councillor Jake Morrison.
Against.
Councillor Kevin Morrison.
Against.
Councillor Mumby.
Against.
Councillor Murray.
Against.
Councillor Navarro. Councillor Nicholas.
Against.
Councillor Noakes.
Against.
Councillor Norris.
Against.
Councillor Anoburn.
Against.
Councillor Rachel Oburn.
Against.
Councillor Orr.
Against.
Councillor Owen. Councillor Prendergast.
Against.
Councillor Prince.
Against.
Councillor Kadir.
Against.
Councillor Radford.
Against.
Councillor Rainey.
Against.
Councillor Rasmussen.
Against.
Councillor Roberts.
Against.
Councillor Robertson Collins.
Against.
Councillor Robertson.
Against.
Councillor Rothery. Councillor Simon.
Against.
Councillor Small.
Against.
Councillor Spurrell.
Against.
Councillor Strickland.
Against.
Councillor Sullivan.
Against.
Councillor Taylor.
Against.
Councillor Thomas.
Against.
Councillor Walker.
Against.
Councillor Walton.
Against.
Councillor Wenston.
Against.
Councillor Williams.
Against.
Councillor Wolfson.
Against.
Councillor Wood.
Against.
Councillor Woodhouse.
Against.
Lord Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. The voting on the amendment is 4 for the amendment, 77 against, no abstentions. Okay, thank you. We'll now move to the second amendment, as moved by Councillor Radford. Councillor Radford, could you wave at me if you want to speak to the amendment, please?
Members of the council, I'm still do feel aggrieved and somewhat puzzled that three components of the amendment model on the table before you, and I find it quite alarming that council officers are discussed with another critical lever the contents of a motion before giving a professional judgment whether it's adequate or not. I thought that would be unprofessional, but I will take that up another place. If I can speak to the broader issues, we are most grateful for the Mayor for being able to take the opportunity to work on the Budget Working Party and have tried to give honest advice and compromise and give positive suggestions to tackling the horrendous situation the city is, and we are proud of that. One of the other particular aspects in the budget process I'm involved was a couple of years ago we had a subcommittee, Working Party, looking at children's centres. And in some ways, some of the content of the motion amendment today reflects that experience. During that review, and I think it was 2 to 3 years ago, I was taken back by the disparity at the premises costs of some of the children's centres. And I did make suggestions, and some were acted upon at that stage, as to how we could drive down more realistic premises costs as a way of being a good alternative to closing those centres. I also put the proposals, and I understand Rosie Jolly, when she was a Liberal Democrat spokesman at the time, also supported the view that we should trial twinning children's centres, reducing the amount of money spent on administration and management, and spending more front-loaded. about the service. And I suppose it was a less than an irony, you know, but a positive follow-on, that when the twinning proposals were implemented, our own Tuesday Centre was one of those that was twinned, and we were twinned with colleagues in West Dartmouth.
Well, can I ask a question, please, of the Chief Executive or of yourself? This isn't an amendment to the budget. I've given an indication in my contribution about the task force that's been set up. If I read that, and I've just read it, and I've read it twice, is that with the greatest respect, if I take you to a section within it, it talks about the council asks centres to consider whether they are current standalone centres and to look at potential benefits of twinning two wards into one team, noting that this has been successful at reducing administration costs. But what it says, Lord Mayor, to me, is very, very clear. It actually says to see if there is potential benefit. Lord Mayor, with greatest respect, he also said that another council member interfered in their amendment. Lord Mayor, I am the Mayor of the city, responsible for the budget. And that's why I intervened when I seen the amendment and gave that advice. We are setting up a task group. This particular motion can be brought at the next council meeting, or it can indeed be brought to the task group. It is not an item. It is not an item for this budget decision-making process. And that's just a simple fact, Lord Mayor.
Right, well, my understanding is that this has been agreed that it is a legal amendment. Is that right, Chief Exec?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. The,